Hey everybody, it's Thursday, and today we're talking about something a little bit different that we haven't really addressed before. This is a topic that I've kind of been resistant to because, in all seriousness and honesty, it's kind of stressful because it's something that we are faced with every day, and to figure out how to not be bathed in it day after day is a little bit stressful.
And to make yourself crazy.
It can make
you crazy. Yeah, get out of it.
So we're talking about electromagnetic frequencies and Wi-Fi and just kind of the general increase in technology and its role in our lives these days. It's increased so much over the last, I mean, even 5 years. Mm-hmm. I feel like, you know, being a Gen Xer, I grew up completely different than the millennials did, where the use of a cell phone was not something I was even faced with until I was like 25 years old, probably.
I'm 10 years old, 15 years old than you.
About somewhere in there.
I used to play with coliforms.
So anyway, it's been something that all of a sudden we've had to deal with, and I just think that the technological advances have been so quick in such a short period of time that our bodies have really not been able to adjust. And we have really good bodies. They've been made supremely well that been able to deal with the different environmental things that are thrown at us. But this is something that now is dealing with our electrical system, which I didn't really understand a whole lot. And so what we're going to talk about today is the effect of EMFs and Wi-Fi on you, on your brain, on your children, on the future generation's brain, and what can we actually do about it instead of just stressing out about it. So I think one of the things that really I didn't understand was I am very much so like a kind of a simple primal. I like to do things simple, but I love my cell phone, and I love technology, and there are things that have made my life so much easier, and I didn't understand really what the harm could be besides not wanting my children to stare at a screen all day just for ability to be able to relate socially, which I know is a whole other topic.
I think in part of it too that we love, not only like you love your cell phone to make your life a little bit easier, but like I love Uber. I like the convenience of Uber. So I think what the bigger picture of this is, we divide it into two parts. One is stuff we've talked about before, that the body has not adapted to the fact that you can be more sedentary because now you can click DoorDash, and anybody that knows me and my story knows that my son Douglas Rhett learned that you can order filet mignon through DoorDash, and all you gotta do is click the phone and it shows up at your door. So even whether it's that, whether it's not being able to actually have to get up and change the TV channel like I had to when I was little, right? We've said that, yeah, it's made us more sedentary.
Right.
But there's that other part of it that says what's floating around in the atmosphere that enables the communication to go from Dougie's phone to the DoorDash guy to the restaurant to come back. And the higher the frequency signals, the more info can get packed into that. So when you push that button in your phone, magically it shows up where it needs to, the information's transferred and the service gets performed. Mm-hmm. We're moving now, when people are starting to talk about driverless cars, we're gonna move to an even higher level of frequency that needs to run along our system, being our world, to get that ton of info to the cars to program them where to go and who to pick up and what to do. And that's why I've been bringing up Uber. If you want somebody to show up, you look at your phone, that stuff is constantly streaming, the info is constantly streaming until you push a button and the driver shows up. Where the issue comes into play that we worry about is who we are. The powerhouse of our cells that make us up are called the mitochondria, and we've talked about mitochondrial preservation a lot on the videos that we do. Where your energy and the basic function of the mitochondria is most important is what's called the electron transport chain. So even if you're not a science major, you've heard of protons and electrons, and you know electrical force is something, quote unquote, to be reckoned with. So we are creating energy through that electron transport chain, and that is transferring to the waves in our brain, right? The electrical waves in our brain. What makes our heart go thump, bump, versus to be in a fibrillative pattern that doesn't fill. Mm-hmm. The muscles that have electrical impulses go down, our nerve nets everywhere. So we are an electrical force. I said I'm reading a book, and I'm just started reading about it, but even when they talk about faith healers in the past, some of the thing, and the guy that wrote this is a doctor, says that those people functioned on a higher frequency, and so that's what passed on, and that's where healing came from. What we're worried about from the other end, I think, is that as technology takes over, we look at our computer screen, we carry our cell phone in our back pocket, we look at the phone all the time, and then as the Wi-Fi goes through your house and the 5G is going to go around everywhere, what is that going to do to our own electrical current as we are trying to go through the aging process? And one of the big issues is, what is it going to do to our young mothers as they are trying to create healthy electrical current, which would be a new baby and the baby's brain? And then now the baby's born, and the first 2-3 years, right, of the baby's life, or some people say 5 years. I mean, I know the brain is always changing, but in the real beginning developmental parts, what is going to happen to the brain of the baby as those nerves are growing and tried to be pruned in an organized way so that thoughts can be talked about, if you would, so people can communicate in an organized way? And how much is that going to lead to autism or learning problems or anything else?
Well, because all of those things, from what you're explaining to me, everything's running on this electrical current for neurotransmitters to be able to submit their message, mm-hmm. to be able to read and comprehend what you're reading, to be able to relate socially, to be able to take in sensory stuff, not feel like things are too loud or too soft. All of those are part of a developmental progress. And I think that that's where the worry is, that it's going to be interrupting those channels that should be forming, mm-hmm. that all of a sudden they're not forming correctly. And so you end up with dyslexia or autism or ADHD or depression or anxiety. I do feel like a lot of people will tell you that they feel more anxious when they're around Wi-Fi or a lot of electromagnetic fields.
And one of the reasons with that is that the microbiome, which we've talked about, our gut bugs, they have a frequency. They vibrate on a certain frequency. And if you dysregulate that and they're dysregulated, they're going right up your vagus nerve to create where your thought process is or isn't, or where your anxiety comes from.
Yeah, and I've even noticed in my kid that's on the spectrum, when he is looking at his phone, and I wasn't sure, is it the color of the screen or is it the content he's looking at? But on those days he can't, and he's a teenager now, so sometimes controlling anger is hard anyway. You know, we all disappear into anger in those teenage years, but his seems to be more amplified on days that he's using his phone a lot. And we've noticed that when he cannot use his phone, because that's our form of punishment, he's a lot easier going to be around. And I've talked to other parents about that who've kind of noticed the same thing in their kids. And so I think now, understanding this electromagnetic issue, a lot of that can be explained. But let's kind of skip ahead towards, because when I'm first thinking about this, all it did was stress me out. I'm like, it's another thing I have to worry about that I need to make sure my family's not coming in contact with. I mean, we can't go and live in a combine. Some people do that, and that's great, but that's just not where my family is. Like, I have to have a job, and I have a job in the city, and so.
Can't pick up and move to Ecuador.
No, I can't. I mean, you know, maybe someone will just give me a lot of money, and then I can, FYI. But as of today, I need to live in this world, and so I want to know how I can reduce this exposure without completely stressing myself out and spending $1 million that I don't have to make my house a completely different place. Because in order to work, we have Wi-Fi and things like that. And so what are some easy things maybe that people can do to reduce this? And we'll talk about the end. We are going to have a seminar on this.
Yeah, so we'll get into detail more with that. But I would say just a handful of things to do in the beginning, and I'm also still in this learning process. One of the biggest things that we miss out on over and over again is sunlight. It regulates your circadian rhythms. When your eyes open in the morning and the retinal cells see the sunlight, it goes into your central nervous system, it sends messages. And I think sunlight, I don't care how much vitamin D you dump into you, the more I read, and yes, don't throw your vitamin D out. I think you definitely need a little bit of supplementation. But your gut microbiome looks around and says, what is this? It wants it through the sun. So I definitely think getting sunlight, and that's also going to help your circadian rhythms normalize. So yes, get out during the day, but getting out kind of on your front lawn. Jack Cruz does a lot of light therapy types of things on his blog. And I think that he says he gets out every morning like the Sphinx, and barefoot, he puts his hands and his feet on the ground. And you know, I did that the other day. My neighbors thought I was a weirdo, but I sat in my front lawn there reading. The second thing we have is we use orange goggles.
I'm all about the demos. I had to show you what it looks like.
And I brought those in the other day, and everybody looked at me like I was from another planet. And my kids think I'm crazy because now I got them watching TV with it at night. But basically what they do is, so if you look up here, can you flash that, Lisa. So those lights are bright. They look great in the office and they're mood lighting, if you will, but that's strong blue light. We've talked about T.S. Wiley's book, Lights Out. It was written, actually, I looked about 15 years ago. She's a woman ahead of her time.
Yeah, she was.
Talked about getting the blue light beating on you at the end of the day, in the gym, when you're on the treadmill, at the end of your long day. So trying to get blue light's okay. It's what you're getting kind of in your morning light, but the warmer lights, which would be, I think you can wear those during the day. I have reading glasses now that have that color on them. So you can wear them inside if your office does have those bright lights, but especially in front of your computer.
Yes.
And we've been watching them at night when you watch TV. So the more orange, these are UVX, I think, UVEX.
Yes.
They're very inexpensive. So they're really orange, but you kind of get used to it when you look at them.
Makes things softer. I like it looking at my computer. Makes my brain feel better.
And I think I'm bad because I have to have my cell phone in my back pocket, but and we'll post a couple of the companies online because I'm still researching them. But what happens is that the phone radiates a lot of the EMF, the electromagnetic field. So there's blockers that you can put on supposedly, and I told my son Andrew this and he laughed in my face and said it's a complete ridiculous that I would think that this would happen. But what they said is when you put this on the phone that the abnormal or the bad EMF that comes out sort of gets changed. It's sort of it benigns it out. It makes it
bends it maybe.
It does something to it that it's not radiating something quite as vicious, if you will. So I'm going to look into that a little bit more, but they do make those online that if you have to carry your phone every day, that will help.
We're going to get into a lot more detail about this. We're going to do a seminar in August. I'm going to post in the comments a link to sign up for the seminar. It's actually going to be in person. But if we have enough interest, we might just do another one that's just completely online. But we're going to talk about how to make your home non-toxic as possible. Mm-hmm. So we'll get into kind of every realm of making like your own cleaning products, which is one way to kind of clean up your house and to make it a lot cheaper too. Skincare stuff, but we're going to talk about how to reduce these EMFs and Wi-Fi.
And some different meters. I'm studying some different meters that maybe you can have that is reasonable. At least you can find sometimes even sanity if you have a weird power line around or something. You can sort of go through your house and just make sure there's nothing that's really...
Because there are things that you can do actually to your electrical outlets. Mm-hmm. There's things you can do to be able to have internet in your house without bathing yourself in Wi-Fi 24/7. So those are some of the things that we're going to talk about and help you come up with easy practical solutions to help. And this is something we're still looking into ourselves and really learning about and kind of delving into. So
we're going to give you more info. We'll give you more on the seminar we're going to have. And remember, the dose, the poison's in the dose. So, right, the poison's in the dose. So like anything else, whenever we talk about food or diet or EMFs or whatever we do, what we're trying to do is take as much pressure off the system as we possibly can. Because if we help your gut and we help your vibration parameters, if you would, huge relationship of that to sleep can help you sleep better, and then that'll put you in more of a positive direction. So we want to try to give you a big picture, understanding that sometimes helping a little bit of everything will really take a big load off. So until then, wear your orange goggles and get some sunshine.